Hello there, and welcome to our review of Andor, Episode 8, Narkeena 5, also known as the prison planet Narkeena 5. And what's on this prison planet? A lot of fucking people.
A lot of people.
And do you know what they're doing on this planet? Snoke is building his empire. Snoke confirmed in Andor, changes the game. This is going to be a wild episode, guys. Just kidding. But the actor who plays Snoke is in this episode, surprisingly. So we gotta do Snoke theories this episode. We got to.
Do we?
We have to.
Do we have to, though?
Yes. Joining me, as always, is the Sith Holocron. Naomi, how you doing?
I do not support these Snoke theories. I do not endorse them, even if I make them.
Now, see, you don't support fun? The funnest thing that's ever happened is Snoke theories.
I mean,
in the history of time.
I mean, I don't know if I'd go that far, but they are pretty fun.
Because they're all ridiculous.
They are pretty fun. But I don't support them as logical, is what I'm saying, even if I'm the one spewing them.
I never support them as logical. That's why they're theories.
Except for the kid.
What kid?
From Revenge of the Sith. The Snoke kid in Revenge of the Sith.
I mean, that's a good one. I don't even know if that's my favorite.
That one's real, though.
That's real life. Yeah, but that's not a theory, though. That's why I was confused.
It's not a theory. It's not a theory. Fact.
It's real life. But no, we'll talk about Snoke later at the end, just for funsies. But Andor Episode 8, what did you think?
Good.
Good?
Good.
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 Borgullet.
Borgullet? Yeah, why didn't we see Borgullet this episode?
You know, where was he? Do you think... That mission he was going to go on, but he didn't, would have been like where they found Borgullet.
I hope so.
And then they just regret it later.
Where that Borgus he at?
This is an interesting episode. Fantastic episode. The show doesn't miss. It's great. Because it does the politics and the fucking spy espionage shit so well that we just spent so much time with characters this episode, even though not much really happened, but like all the conversations were really good.
Very intriguing.
With the highlight for me being Saw's and Luthen's conversation. But Saw's just an interesting character because he is very much... We know what he is. He's a rebel, but he's like, I don't agree with anyone else. And it was interesting when he was like listing off all like the factions and like all the types of believers in the rebellion and like all the causes, and I'm like... Yeah.
He would have a special hatred for the Separatists.
Yeah.
Given what they did to his planet and his sister.
Right. There's no wonder why he doesn't want to work with them.
Yeah. And then I like... I was caught off guard when he was talking about, like, a Republic person. He was, like, an ex-Republican. And I just never heard them referred to as Republicans.
Yeah.
And I was like, what is that?
He said a lot. I didn't really, like, 100% know what they... Well, I understood what, like, they were, but I'm like, I don't know. There are a lot for Star Wars. There's just so many, like...
Yeah, there's a lot of factions.
Yeah.
There are a lot of little cells, you know?
He said cultists. That was fun.
Yeah. Yeah, what was it? Like, human cultists or whatever?
Yeah.
So I would assume, like, what? Like, human supremacists?
Probably.
Isn't that just the Empire, though?
Yeah. I don't know.
I think it is, because the Empire doesn't hire aliens, so...
Yeah. Like, they don't imprison aliens, either. There's not a single alien in this prison.
They imprison them in the worst prisons.
Yeah, because they probably don't find them as able-bodied people, so they're like...
No, they don't view... Well, you called them people. The Empire doesn't do that. The Empire doesn't really view aliens as people, I would assume.
Yeah.
I've just, you know... I mean, the Empire is like... fascist, so clearly they just don't... The other things are just bad and not human.
Yeah. But I loved Luthen's point in that conversation, where he's like, if we... Like, there's no way any of us can... Unless we don't come together at some point, we're never gonna...
You can't be rebel. A unified threat with 12 ununified forces.
Yeah. And he's not wrong.
No, he isn't wrong.
And... Of course, Saw being Saw.
That's ultimately why Saw's partisans failed. Because they were alone.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, they're partisans.
Yeah, they were the partisans.
Partisans are also called dreamers.
Yeah, yeah. they didn't team up with anyone. They didn't want to be allied with anyone, and then they ultimately were pretty much eradicated.
Yeah.
So, it's what happens.
Save the rebellion. Save the dream.
I like that, I feel like for the first time we heard what Saw's leaning is. He's an anarchist, is what Luthen called him.
Yeah. Well, he pretty much is.
No, yeah, I mean, we could have assumed that, but that's the first time we've heard it, like, what he, like, actually is.
No, he's a partisan.
Partisan for anarchy.
I mean, anarchist is just, like, how their style, you know?
Well, anarchy is how their, like, ideal government structure is.
Oh, yeah.
Partisan is just their organization.
I feel like they don't have an ideal government structure.
You do realize that's what anarchy is.
I was gonna say, I feel like they don't really think about that. They're just like, we don't want the Empire. I feel like they don't really care what the structure is, as long as it's just not the Empire.
I feel like at very least Saw, it makes sense that he is full anarchist. Like, just no government, period.
Maybe.
Because he hated all of the government.
Oh, yeah.
He hated the Separatists, he hated the Republic, he hates the Empire, like, I don't think I don't think he wants to replace it with anything, I think he just wants it gone.
Yeah.
Just everybody go back to being, like, tribes, I guess. I don't know.
He's like, we need Gaia, we need to redo the Earth, and...
I mean, I guess, you know, I guess maybe the Star Wars sense of anarchy would just be, like, isolationism, where it's just, like, every planet just keeps to themselves. And there's no, like, interplanetary government.
States laws.
States laws.
He's a big fan of states' rights.
Yeah. Yeah, Saw's a very big states' rights guy.
Less federal government, more...
No, that is literally what he is, I know. Think. That's so funny. Although, yeah. I don't think he even wants the states' laws.
No, yeah.
He's very much just an isolationist, I feel like.
Yeah.
Just leave everybody, just get the fuck away.
That conversation, though, was between them was fascinating.
It really was.
And people say Star Wars shouldn't do politics. Fuck off. They're killing it.
It's also always been political.
Yeah.
It has war in the name.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I was thinking, like, that...
No, it's called Andor, not Andor.
Like, I just kept thinking, like, during, like, all the scenes, like, Mon Mothma and Luthen talking with Saw and all that, I just kept thinking of that one tweet I think we talked about before, where it was, like, the guy's like, oh, I hate that Star Wars is getting all political now, and then the, like, Star Wars Twitter account was like, it has war in the name.
Yeah.
It started as an analogy of, like, Vietnam.
Yeah.
Like... It was always very political, because the Empire is just America.
I don't think that's...
No, that's what it is.
Lucas in the 80s said the Empire was America.
Yes, because the rebels were Vietnam. They were the Viet Cong.
I don't know anything about any of that. Like, I'm not a history person.
The rebellion is, like, that's how he explains how they won on Endor, because we got fucked in Vietnam.
Like, I couldn't tell you what happened in Vietnam.
You mean we got pretty owned from my... I mean, I'm not a big history person either, but I know it is similar in the way that, like, the less technologically advanced people were just, like, not, like, stomping, because I think we just burned everything down, but...
Yeah.
But, like, they were winning in numbers games by just killing more people because they knew the terrain and shit.
Mm.
And Lucas said, like, yeah, like, it was analogous of Vietnam... And then, like, people were like, wait, so does that mean that the Empire is America? Yeah.
I always thought the Empire was more, like... I feel like the Empire is America now. More,
yeah.
More than, like...
Well, we've always been pretty imperialist.
Yeah.
It's just weird to think that Lucas was a woke moralist back in the day. I mean, I don't know if he still is. I don't know anything about him, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I just always think that's funny. So, like, when they were taught, when, like, the politics talks were in this episode, I just kept thinking of that.
Yeah.
So people are like, oh, I hate when it gets, when franchises get all political, but Star Wars began politically.
I don't, but if this isn't even political, it's just doing politics.
Yeah.
Just doing politics in the world of Star Wars. That's not political.
People don't like that.
But that's not inherently political.
I mean, I think it's more that people are upset that you could draw, like, analogies to reality that make them look bad.
Mm. Well, that's just people being insecure.
At least that's what I would assume.
Yeah. I don't know.
Because every time there's a shitty Imperial citizen in Star Wars, it's really weird because it is very much just like a present-day Republican.
Yeah.
Like the guys that Mon Mothma was talking to.
Like the ISB guy. Not the ISB guy, the Marinacop guy.
Yeah, yeah, he's big.
Anyone who's horny for Law and Order, you don't trust them.
Definitely not in America.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, like, when Mon Mothma was at the party and they were talking, and the one guy was like, well, if you haven't done anything wrong, you should be okay with it. It's just funny how, like, they have, like, the same takes, and it's really weird.
Yeah.
I like the Mon Mothma scenes in this show.
I know, she's fucking... What's the word? She's serving.
Yeah.
The C word. She's fucking... fine as hell. Look at all them dresses, you know?
Yeah, I like her outfits.
Yeah.
I'm not a big fan of Mon Mothma's, like pacifism, but I do like the scenes of her talking with people.
I mean, she's anti-Empire.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like...
But she's just too pacifistic for my liking.
I feel like she's not that, like... I feel like you're projecting her history onto her in this show.
No, yeah, but we know she becomes pacifistic.
Yeah, but, like, we gotta see how she gets there.
I mean, I just don't like pacifism in Star Wars.
But aren't you a pacifist? You would never fight someone.
Yeah, that's because I would die.
Yeah.
I'm a pacifist purely because my body is already trying to destroy me just from since birth. So, like, I...
But you're a big girl. You could fuck some people up.
No. I can't. I can't, like... I have no strength. I could maybe kick someone...
So, are you telling me you're the Mon Mothma
No.
of the powerful Thigh Syndicate?
No, because I'm not a pacifist by choice.
Mm.
I'm a pacifist by necessity. Like, if I had a mech suit,
yeah,
then I would be...
You would just be ruthlessly murdering people in the street. You'd be Saw Gerrera at that point. You just kill people
No,
for
I wouldn't
sport.
Be Saw Gerrera. There's a middle ground.
No. Nuance
no.
does not exist.
I was just about to say, what do you mean, no?
Do you not know where we live? Earth. With humans. You wonder why the aliens haven't invaded us yet? Because nuance doesn't exist here, and they're like, we can't deal with these people. They need to be extinct.
I mean, I get it, but that's what I mean. Like, there is, like, Saw and Mon form... the two extreme ends of the spectrum, where they're both, like, Saw is more harm than good, Mon is still good, like, she is helpful, she is useful, she does good things.
I feel like Mon Mothma is not, I get she's a pacifist, I don't, has the lore ever specifically stated she's a pacifist, or...
Yeah.
I feel like she's not as pacifistic as you make her out to be, I just think... you deeply hold the grudge of her shutting down the army, and you'll never forgive her.
I'll never forgive her for...
Because I feel like she's not, like, when they portray her, when we see her, she's not that pacifistic. I feel like she's more, like Luthen said, a coward. But, like, afraid of, like, she's more, like, annoyingly meticulous.
Also, she is just the scapegoat for the reason why the New Republic was destroyed so easily, because Disney didn't know how to write it correctly.
Yeah.
She was just the scapegoat for that, I will say. I mean, it is some level, like, kind of a meme, my disdain for Mon Mothma.
Yeah.
Like, it's not all real disdain.
She just got a little, like, hotter, so I'm like, I gotta defend Mon Mothma. You know? No, but, yeah, I'm excited for if the show delves into all three of them coming together and, like, all the factions start bleeding together at some point.
Also,
I don't know about this season, but next season for sure.
And also, you know, I mean, I would assume a lot of her pacifism is more legends-based as well.
Yeah, I don't know.
because I don't know anything about Legends. I just know that she is fairly pacifistic, and I kind of choose that to meme on, to just, like, harp on it. Like, oh, I hate that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's a series I like to see fighting.
Yeah.
Like, if she was, like, a real person, she'd be, like, the ideal person.
I feel like she's a good, though, foil for everyone else she's against. Like she's a good Luthen and, like, Saw Gerrera foil. Like, we need all of them.
See, I just hate pacifists in fiction.
Yeah.
Because I want to see people fight.
Yeah.
Like, if we were to, you know, if every Star Wars Rebel was to be a real person, she would be probably the best.
Hey, you want to know who the one of the best pacifists ever is? The Duchess Satine.
True.
Pacifists can be cool, you know?
They can be cool, but, like...
Like, she was the leader of, was it Mandalore, right?
Yeah.
Right? And they're, like, Mandalorians, and they're fighters, and she was a pacifist. That's pretty metal.
I mean,
you know she a badass.
It was pretty metal. I'm just a fan of there being a middle ground.
Yeah.
Some violence is acceptable. In fiction.
That's why Luthen's your favorite, right?
No, yeah, because it makes for interesting, like, I like it. And I do agree.
I think he's the perfect middle ground between Saw and...
Yeah.
Mon.
And I do also agree with you. She's a great foil for it.
Yeah.
Like, my meme of hating her is just a meme.
And it's interesting, too, with the, because I feel like he's, like, I like Luthen a lot, too, because he's a little more, like, passionate, too.
Yeah.
Because, like, he has his lady who works for him. I think her name starts with an H. I don't know for sure. But, like, who's, like, you need to shut this shit down. I know you want to go find Cassian and to kill him, but, like... And make sure he doesn't know anything, but, like, you need to stop. We're going to get caught. But he's like, we're out in the open. I got to show myself now. Let's fuck shit up.
You know what I'm realizing slowly over this review?
The show's amazing.
I mean, I already knew
10
that.
Out of 10. Master.
If I was only realizing it now, there would be a big problem.
I mean...
No.
It'd be funny if this is the episode where you're like, yeah, I think the show's good, even though this was the episode where I'm like... Great, but also I'm like, I still don't know where you're going.
Yeah.
Like, how is Cassian get out of prison?
No, the thing that I'm realizing is that my meme of hating Mon Mothma started back when I was a very different person. And because the more I was thinking about it, I was like, wait, I kind of just agree with her on, like, everything.
Yeah. She's not terrible. But she's not, like... It's easy to meme on her shutting down the army, which caused the First Order to rise up and fucking take shit over. Like, she
but it's
fucked
funny,
up.
But, like, the more that I'm thinking about it, like, that is something that I would like. Like, that is, like, a political opinion that I would agree with.
Yeah.
So it's just funny to realize, like, oh, wait.
Yeah.
But it's for the sake of fiction, you know?
Oh, yeah.
You gotta have, like...
Yeah.
I action.
I don't need fiction to be exactly what I believe, you know?
Yeah. Because also, if it was exactly what I would think would be the best course of action, then there would be a lot more peace.
Be a lot less drama, too.
A lot less drama.
You know?
It's the same thing with, like Game of the Thrones. Like, Game of Thrones. Game of the Thrones, as I almost said.
Game of the Thrones of the Dragon of the House.
Like, monarchies are horrifically terrible for everyone, but they make great fiction.
I think monarchies are, like, the best for fiction.
But horrific in reality.
Yeah.
But amazing for fiction.
Same.
Sorry, way. I was just having, like, an identity crisis during this episode.
You're welcome.
From my old beliefs back in the day. Shit's wild.
Another highlight from this episode, which made my heart so full, was seeing Bix, the man, and Cassian's mom together. What's her name again?
Oh, fuck.
I almost said Morana.
What is her name?
I don't remember. I don't remember the guy's name either.
They mostly just call her Mom.
Yeah. I can find it real quick. But
yeah, look it up. Yeah, that was a very sweet scene.
I just loved seeing them all together. I'm like, I miss them. And honestly, just being back on Ferrix, I'm like, oh, it's the one guy who owed him money. I'm like, oh, I miss them.
I also really like that they, like, are worried about her and trying to take care of her.
Yeah.
Even though they're not, like, related.
Yeah, it's because they're... It's just, despite how Cassian can be to them, sometimes they still care about Cassian and her.
And also, she's a sweet old lady.
Yeah.
I just think that's very heartwarming.
Who's in her rebellion arc very late in life.
Who's in her, like, rebellious teenage phase.
Yeah.
Is it like Marva? Marva?
Marva?
Marva?
I think it's Marva.
It might be Marva.
That sounds right. We're going to say Marva.
Is it not... Is she not listed?
Yeah, it's Marva.
Lit.
Marva Andor.
Yeah. I loved that. Them just being really concerned.
Yeah. And it was... That was, I just like being back on Ferrix in general.
Yeah.
We saw Vel and Cinta there, which was like... We got more... They together.
Yeah, we got lesbianism confirmed.
Pretty much, even though we knew. It's just confirmed now.
Now, I want it to be one of those moments, and this happens in real life a lot, where people will see, like, lesbians, and then be like, oh, but they were just really good roommates. That's my favorite thing ever.
Why?
Just because it's so funny to just be that oblivious that, like, lesbians exist. Like, it's fucked up in, like, erasure, obviously.
Yeah.
But I just think it's funny to joke about.
Oh, okay.
Like, because any, like, historical example, if you ever hear, like, in history, like, two women were, like, really good roommates or, like, really close friends and they happened to live together, they were obviously lesbian. Like, you can find, like, a lot of times it's like they wrote, like, love poems to each other and shit, and it's like people were like, no, they were just roommates.
Yeah.
So I love that. Yeah. So I want to see people on Twitter saying that about Cinta and Vel.
I'm sure.
Because heterosexual people are very oblivious unless it's explicitly stated.
Yeah.
Unless they're like, I am lesbian for you, then they will just think it's not that.
Yeah. But kind of interesting tangent I can bring up, which is something I want to tell you about, just period. You know, in the book of Fire and Blood, Alicent and Rhaenyra weren't as close as they were in the show, and a lot of people are mad about that because they feel like they're like queer baiting them. So that's like another interesting tangent of like that kind of thing. Like, you don't, it's like you don't want to queer bait, but you also don't want to, you know.
Yeah
apparently that, like, they, it's not like, yeah, but I don't know.
See, I will always believe that they were in love.
I don't care. Like, they're in love.
Yeah, I will always. Facts. I will always believe that they were romantically into each other. Yeah. I don't care what.
Even if they're not, I like that characterization for whatever their relationship was in the past for the show.
Yeah,
just saying. I just
interesting. Interesting, yeah.
But yeah, what else about Andor? I don't want to go too long because we have
Tales of the Jedi
to watch and review all of them.
Yeah. The prison was very bleak.
Yeah. So the only thing about the prison where I believe they hinted at a way Cassian escapes is the guys talking to each other via sign language. I feel like that was the hint of, like, okay, there's... But other than that, like, Cassian, it was just him going... It was showing him getting acclimated to the...
Yeah.
Prison life.
He's been there a month.
Yeah.
Wild.
And wild that fucking their leader is fucking Andy Serkis, Supreme Leader Snoke. Fucking wild. I made noise when I saw him. I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't know what you were, like, saying what the fuck about at the time. I was, like, scanning the screen, like, if you saw something weird.
Yeah, because I didn't know he was going to be in the show. It was a fun surprise. Glad he got another role in Star Wars. Other than Snoke, because that's the nice part about Snoke is, like, your CG, you just voiced him, and the voice is, and obviously you're doing a voice, so, like, you can just be yourself and act, and...
Yeah.
This was just an interesting place for him to pop up. I wonder if... He had a name, right? I don't remember his name. I wonder if he's someone who exists in canon that we know of, like, the novels or something.
What was his name?
I have no
fucking clue. I don't remember. What's Cassian's new cover name?
Creef? Criff?
Criff?
Creef? Krig? I don't remember.
He has so many cover names.
Yeah. Clem? Which also, we learned, was heartbreaking because that was his dad's name.
That's a shame.
But, that was fascinating. I'm like, this is cool. I wonder how, like I said, I don't want him to be in prison for, like, the rest of the season.
I don't think he will be for the rest of the season.
Yeah. Because, like, I know this season takes place over a year, and the next season covers the next 4 years leading up to Rogue One. So I'm like, what is the play here? Is this where, like, is it just, like, the next four episodes are Cassian and Luthen trying to find Cassian and getting him out of prison, keeping him and making sure he gets stayed in prison so he doesn't have to kill him? Or is this where they, like, something happens where they're like, we gotta stick together and, like, yeah, we're in it together?
I think this is definitely part of the radicalization.
Yeah.
This injustice that he's faced.
But also, like, I feel like this, the injustice, though, is also not probably fully realized in because of him realizing what they did on Aldani is fucking over the people in prison.
Yeah.
Which was an interesting thing that happened.
That is such a wild thing.
Because that would be, I'd feel guilty about that if I was Cassian.
Oh, yeah. It's just funny. Empire gets robbed. Okay, double everyone's sentences in the entire prison system.
Yeah.
Like, what is the correlation? I don't get it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
they just need to work harder so they can make more of that money back.
Yeah. Yeah, I like Star Wars television giving us a lot of suicides.
Yeah.
I just think it's a funny little like
is this like a one on the list of, like, was there another one?
There was like three or four in the Clone Wars.
Oh, okay. But the guy jumped on the hot floor.
Yeah. I'm surprised that it just fucking killed him.
I'm sure he didn't kill him, like, immediately, but, like, he was on there, and then it just eventually gets him.
True.
And then he, like, falls, and then it's, like, burning everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that I feel like that would be, like, a near nightly occurrence.
Yeah.
Because that shit is bleak. I like that they have to eat out of a hose.
Yeah.
I think that's just funny.
Yeah, that is funny. Like, they have the hose, and if they get the most, they get flavor. Yeah. Like, what the fuck?
Like, it's funny in, like, a horrifically terrifying way.
Yeah.
It's just wild.
Okay, so
I like the whole scene of, like, in the ISB, where, like, they were trying to get Colonel Yularen to agree to this, like, whole extreme plan, and, like, Cyril was trying to slide his way in.
Yeah. Cyril, hate him.
I hate him.
He's like, there's nothing more important than law and order. I'm like, I don't think I'm glad she didn't be like, yeah, come with me. I feel like I wouldn't be shocked if, like, that happened, though. Like, I was, because they did the 30-day jump, and I was just expecting to see him there in, like, an Imperial outfit.
I feel like she is going to go to him.
Yeah. I can't.
We've seen too much of him for him to not be, like, involved.
I like her as a compelling, interesting Imperial officer, but, like, the moment she put Bix in the chair, you gotta die. Like, we can't have this anymore. You don't fuck with Bix.
Gonna throw hands.
Gonna throw fucking hands, yo.
Yeah, that's fair.
So, whatever they're making a lot of.
Yes.
Do we believe that whatever they're making is the only thing they're making in this entire facility, or just their section? And two, they're making a lot of them, so what could they be? And how could it have to do with the prisoner actually not being a prisoner, but he's actually part of the Imperial officer, like the leader on the ground? And how does this turn him into Snoke?
Well, I would assume, I think they're building Star Destroyer parts.
Yeah, or, yeah, they're definitely have parts for ships or something.
Yeah, like Star Destroyers. Because we know the Empire produces the fuck out of some Star Destroyers.
Yeah.
They have just millions of those fuckers. So
I assume each floor has, like, a specific,
yeah,
thing they're working on.
I think each one builds a different part.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's, like, each, like, of the, because there are, like, 10 platforms. Maybe each platform builds all of one part.
That'd be a lot, though. That'd be overkill. 12 hours a day working on, like,
for
a whole facility working on. I don't know what those are.
Do you understand how big a Star Destroyer is, though?
Yeah.
One Star Destroyer would need probably so many of those pieces.
But what are they? We don't know what they are.
I don't know. Something with the mechanics on the inside. But a Star Destroyer is, like,
yeah,
is, like, fucking gigantic. Venators were huge. Imperial Star Destroyers are 50% bigger than Venators. And then First Order Resurgent Class Star Destroyers are 50% bigger than that. So, like, by the time you get to, like, the First Order ones, they're, like, the size of, like, fucking, like, cities, basically.
Yeah.
You're just building, like, cities. So, like, you need a lot of them, I would assume. Because I would assume that it is, like, probably more of, like, a... just, like, a common piece that's needed and not, like, a... you know, not, like, a super, like, important... like, it's not, like, a reactor part or some shit.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe it is, I don't know.
Maybe. It almost, every time I look at it, I'm like, oh, that's like a rim for a tire. But a bigger one, so maybe it's like something, it looks like something that would like spin, you know?
I mean, we know there's like hundreds of thousands, if not millions of like inhabited planets.
Yeah.
They needed a lot of Star Destroyers to oppress all those planets.
True. What if they're just like fans, like ceiling fans?
Those are thick ceiling fans. Very ineffective.
Industrial fans.
Those are not aerodynamic.
Let's be honest. Even the Empire's, like, even to, like, their ranks, like, you can suffer a little in the heat. We don't need fans.
Yeah, of course. They don't give a fuck.
Yeah. But how does this play into Snoke coming back? So
here's what we're thinking.
Snoke's in Andor now. So, like, what? How does this work?
I have it.
Yeah.
So... obviously, Andor is going to escape.
Yeah.
We are aware of that. Snoke is going to try and stop him, and Andor is going to throw him overboard into the water pussy.
Into one of, like, the circling things.
Into the water pussy.
Into the wussy,
where he's going to drown, and then he turns into Snoke.
And down there, he... yeah.
The Sith cultists are down there.
Yeah.
Just waiting.
Okay.
They knew it was coming.
We should name this episode... Andor review season 1 episode 8 title parentheses all caps Snoke is alive.
Oh, just like that one that we had a couple weeks ago that was Andor review parentheses sort of.
Yeah. We should.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Because I already got the thumbnail. It's a picture of them two together. So.
Okay.
But yeah, we're gonna. Anything we not cover, because I'm ready to wrap it up and watch some Tales of the Jedi and eat some food.
Yeah, I think...
and I gotta go potty.
I think we got it.
Yeah. Great episode. I can't wait for more. I love this show. I want to see the rest of it.
I want all of season 2 to be out now.
And if they hurt Bix, I swear to fucking God. Hell to pay.
What are you gonna do?
I'm gonna cancel my Disney Plus subscription.
You're gonna... Do you think, just one final question for you.
Okay.
Do you think Cyril would storm the Senate building?
I know exactly where Cyril was on January 6th.
He was at the Imperial Senate building.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure.
So until next time, everyone like, subscribe, share, comment down below. Tell us what you think. Do you uphold law and order like Cyril? Where is Snoke? How is he turned into Snoke? Is he alive? I don't remember that man's name, but I'm like, that name sounds like it's a real name, so maybe he's from a book or something. Like, subscribe, comment, share, and just until next time. Cassian Andor.